spaces, which is very exciting, and as well as folks who are joining us for the first time. So welcome. Grace Evans. I am the Chief of Staff at One Neighborhood Builders. We launched this series, this Fresh Friday series, to really create a space for practitioners and community members and policymakers and others to learn and share about community development, especially topics that are emerging or gaining traction in the field, like that which we will discuss today, which is participatory budgeting. So before we get started, just a few notes on logistics for the day. First, note that the meeting will be recorded, as we intend to share it with interested folks who were not able to join us during the session today. Second, if you have any comments or questions for our panelists while the panel is underway, please feel free to leave it in the chat. We'll have a opportunity for Q&A at the end of the call, where we'll refer back to some of the questions left in the chat, as well as just open the floor for folks to share anything that they'd like to learn more about. And as always, third, if you're not actively speaking, please remember to keep your microphone muted. For those who just joined, as we're doing this introduction here, would also love for you to introduce yourself in the chat, and please feel free to use it as a resource for discussion throughout today's session. So with all of that said, let's kick this off. So as I mentioned, today our discussion topic is participatory budgeting. And we're joined by our first panelist, who I would like to kick off with, Pam Jennings, who is truly an expert on participatory budgeting and is currently working with the State of Rhode Island's Executive Office of Health and Human Services and the Department of Health on two of the participatory budgeting projects, which you'll hear more about today throughout the conversation. Pam, can you please share your pronouns, tell us a little bit about yourself, and then help answer for this crowd, what is participatory budgeting? And what do we know about its use in other places around the US and the world?
Sure. It's great to see everyone this morning. Thanks all for being here. So my name is Pam Jennings. I use she, her pronouns. And I've been working in the space of participatory budgeting, or we can use the acronym PB if that's easier, for about the past 12 years. And I'm a technical assistance provider, so I help train cities and districts and school districts about how to implement participatory budgeting within their budgets. So it's a democratic process in which community members are in the driver's seat, right? So community members directly decide how to spend part of a public budget. It's been something that's been emerging over the past 30 plus years, originated in Porto Alegre, Brazil, and has spread really all throughout the world. Around 2010 was the first time in the United States that participatory budgeting started to take hold. So Chicago and New York City, a couple of places in California. So it's really starting to pick up momentum here around the United States. Central Falls was actually the first city in Rhode Island to implement PB back in 2019, giving high school students direct say over $10,000 on how to improve their school. And since then, there's been several other PB processes in Central Falls. But the basic idea is that we're giving community members direct say at every single level, right? So from the beginning, a steering committee comes together to create the rules, and shout out to Maria, Nada, Daniel, right, our great steering committee members who are here with us today. So from every level, from the beginning of like creating the rules of the process, it's community driven. So steering committee makes the rules, then we go out to the community to gather ideas. We develop concrete project proposals with community members, and then everyone gets to vote, right? So everyone, regardless of their eligibility to vote in regular elections. In 0908, 0299, it will be young people as young as 13 that will be allowed to vote. So it's a several months long process, right? It's not just like a couple weeks and we're done with the process, right? It will be going on until May within the health equity zones.
Thank you, Pam. Yeah, that's great. No, I'm sure we'll be coming back to you for some more of that expertise. Appreciate you kind of laying the groundwork here. I next want to introduce another one of our panelists, Liz Marrera, who works at LISC Rhode Island. And I would love, Liz, for you to tell us a little bit more about yourself, share your pronouns, and talk about the participatory budgeting project that LISC is involved in right now.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me today. I am Liz Marrera. I use she, her pronouns, and I am an assistant program officer for Local Initiative Support Corporation, or LISC, which is the backbone agency for the Pawtucket Central Falls Health Equity Zone. And we are excited to be piloting this program along with One Neighborhood Builders and the Central Providence Initiative. And our steering committee are a group of residents from Pawtucket and Central Falls, and they named our program Together We Can, or Unidos Podemos, or Unidos Podemos, to be translated across the dominant languages in Pawtucket Central Falls, which is English, Spanish, Portuguese, and Cape Verdean Creole. So our question to our community is, how would you invest $385,000 to make Pawtucket and Central Falls healthier? So it's super important for community engagement to ensure that our residents are at the forefront and are at the table and making decisions that impact their cities around social determinants of health. And I feel that we are at a critical point in recovery from the COVID pandemic to come together and really see how we can recover in a way that is equitable and also is representative of the people that we serve. So we are super excited to be part of this initiative, and I'll leave it at that for now, because I'm pretty sure I can get deeper into our process later.
Thank you so much. I will now turn it to Dominique Resendiz, who is the Assistant Director of Place-Based Initiatives at One Neighborhood Builders. Dominique, can you please share your pronouns, talk a little bit about yourself, and then share more about One Neighborhood Builders' participatory budgeting effort, similar to how Liz shared about Pawtucket Central Falls.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for being here. My name is Dominique Resendiz. I use she, her pronouns. And I'm working really closely with the steering committee, Lucy, Pam, Liz, the Pawtucket Central Falls team. And our process is called the Nine Neighborhood Fund, because as folks may know, within 02908 and 02909, there's nine different neighborhoods within those two zip codes. And so we, you know, after lots of different ideas and lots of narrowing down votes, we finally came up with Nine Neighborhood Fund as the name of our initiative. And so for our project, we are fortunate enough to be able to match the state funding that has been allocated for this participatory budgeting process with private funding to have $1 million that is allocated through this process. And so the way that we're framing this question is, if you had $1 million, how would you distribute funds in your neighborhoods? And so in our role as One Neighborhood Builders in this is really just providing, you know, the logistical support so that the steering committee can really see this vision through.
Thank you, Dominique. An excellent segue. As the next person and the final panelist who I'd like to introduce is Maria Gomes, who's a member of the Nine Neighborhood Fund's Participatory Budgeting Steering Committee. Maria, I would love if you could introduce yourself, share your pronouns, and then could you talk a little bit about how you got involved in the steering committee and what really interested you about it?
Hello, everyone. Thanks for having me here. So my pronouns are she, her, and hers. As Grace mentioned, I am one of the steering committee members. What has brought me here? So it is my first time participating in PB. I feel very empowered to be a voice for my community. I'm grateful to be given the opportunity to meet and collaborate with such amazing, wonderful people in the committee who are very passionate. We share the same concerns, we share the same interests. Everyone is very smart and bring different experiences. I like the idea of like working together and advocating for our community and just basically creating innovative policy simply makes me like very happy, to be honest.
Thank you, Maria. And thanks for sharing a little bit about your experience on the steering committee. We're going to get into it more. I want to go back to Pam for the next question. So Pam, we just heard, especially Dominique and Liz, speaking about the resources that are available to distribute in the community, some of which are from public sources, and then there's also some private funding for the 9 Neighborhood Fund. Could you talk a little bit about the public dollars and the way that those resources became available or how it's connected to some of the health equity work that's happening in the state? Oh, and Pam, you're on mute.
Yes. yes, I would love to. And I'm also just going to just mention that Allegra is here on the call with us too. And you know, Allegra, if you want to jump in at any time with a little bit more of the background information. So the Executive Office of Health and Human Services developed a health systems transformation project strategic plan. And among many other things, which other people on this call could probably speak better to, participatory budgeting is just one of the aspects of the strategic plan around improving social determinants of health. So a total of $900,000 was set aside for participatory budgeting, understanding that it's the residents that know best what they need to improve the conditions that are going to make our communities healthier. And so I think that's the fundamental understanding is that residents know best, right, of what they need. And so the allocation was made through the Executive Office of Health and Human Services, originating from Medicaid funds, actually. The health equity zone structure within the Rhode Island Department of Health really made a lot of sense to be kind of the vehicle to make this happen because the health equity zones are already so rooted in the community and it's their mission and purpose to improve health outcomes, right, in the communities that they work in.
Thank you, Pam. Very helpful and kind of demonstrates the importance of all the players kind of along the continuum of making this happen from the decision-making and leadership at the state level to the strength of the health equity zones as real conveners and amplifiers of community voice in the two communities specifically, which we're talking about. I wanted to now jump back to Dominique, in fact. And maybe Dominique and Liz, you can tag team this. I would actually love to hear how the two health equity zones have worked together or coordinated or collaborated as you've been advancing these two distinct but on the same track initiatives in your respective communities.
I can start, and then Liz, if I miss anything, let me know. Honestly, it has been so tremendously helpful to have another HES alongside us doing this process. Honestly, I think one of the most valuable is just sharing, you know, being able to have another HES that you can share challenges with, that you can, just bounce ideas off of. Sometimes together we can, we'll try something before us and then we get to learn from their lessons. Sometimes we try something first and they get to learn from ours. So really just the learning that happens and just like all the document templates and more of a logistical way.
Yeah, I would add that we're fortunate to have like spaces created where both heads can come together and share best practices, go over observations from our meetings and evaluation, and ensuring that we're exactly doing what we're meant to do. And then also collaborating on like communications. We have radio ads through Poder and other communication ways that we're getting PB out and going on shows together and talking about the program as a whole. I think it's been an awesome experience having that other backbone agency going through the same process as us at the same time and just bouncing ideas off each other.
Thank you both. I'm inspired. That's a warm and fuzzy feeling to hear about the collaboration. Maria, I wanted to turn it back to you. Pam, when she was talking through some of the process components of this work in her initial comments, described how one of the first things that happens is the steering committee develops the rules for the process. So I understand that this rulemaking is something that the Nine Neighborhood Fund Steering Committee has done a lot of work on to date. It may in fact even be done. You can tell me one way or the other. Could you talk a little bit about like what was that rulemaking process like? What were some of the decisions or things that the steering committee thought through as you worked through that process?
Again, as I mentioned earlier, the working together piece is a huge component, and then just kind of developing the rule book, but also being very careful to make decisions together and be creative and find innovative and culturally sensitive ways to like meet our residents where they're at. So those were one of the most important piece. In terms of like creating the rule book, we it was a lot of like back and forth. There were times that we didn't agree. so we created like different voting methods that seems fair so that we can cast our vote in the end. Some of the decision makings were very challenging. And then there are other times that they were not as challenging as we expect them to be. In the end, we all just came and made a decision together and it worked out. Again, I think with any other place, you will get, you know, you'll reach these challenges, but that's what makes us amazing. That's what makes working together. You know, we reach a goal and we basically defined our goals together. We agreed on those goals. So our next process is just basically to build relationship with our residents and educate them about the fund opportunity. And then now we're at just working with the community and trying to get their inputs and their ideas.
Thank you so much. Really helpful to hear kind of about how you were able to kind of bring these different voting processes and things like that to help make collective decisions. Not to put you on the spot, but are there any specific decisions that you could talk about that were either really easy or really challenging, just to help paint the picture for folks who are new to this process? Like, what are some of those things that really have to be wrestled with when putting together one of these programs?
That's a good question, Grace. So now you got my brain just like thinking back. Okay. So, I think most of the decision wasn't as like easy 1, 2, 3, unless it's just like a general decision that we all had to make together. It did require a lot of critical thinking in terms of like, again, meeting where our residents, where they're at. And thinking of like, okay, let's think about the elders, like, let's think about the children, let's think about the, you know, the people in 02908 and 02909, you know, what does that look like? So we had to kind of look at what was helpful is that we had to kind of look at some of the things that Central Falls had, you know, worked on. And those kind of gave us a little bit of like knowledge of like how we can move forward with certain decision-making and stuff. And then kind of looking at cases. And I found that to be very helpful. And then we then could create our own goal or our own process and what that looks like for our community, specific to our community. So it was a lot of those little pieces put in together. I'm not sure if that, does that answer your question?
No, that's great. Thank you. Yeah, it's helpful just to hear a little bit more of that context of what these things have really looked like. Pam, I wanted to go back to you because, so we just spent a little time talking about what is, you know, sort of one of the very first phases of a kind of a PB process, which is developing the rules, having the steering committee develop the rules. Can you give a sort of a high level overview of what some of the, what the rest of the steps are? How do you get from there to money going out to community led projects?
Mm-hmm. So after the rule book is created, the first phase is we call it idea collection, basically, to keep it simple. And that's, you know, happens over a couple of months. I think we started like back in September and we'll wrap up, you know, probably in the middle of December. And that's just the opportunity to like hit the ground, talk to people about what they, you know, what first, what are the issues that they see, and then what are solutions that they have to address those issues. And so we do that in a lot of different ways. We try and, you know, like I think Maria has been saying, like, you know, figuring out the culturally appropriate ways to do it, meeting people where they're at. So everything from like town hall meetings to sitting in the senior center and talking to folks at the senior center to going to PTA meetings. And shout out to Michael, who is here with us as well, who's been doing a lot of the great outreach. To like posting drop boxes out in the community, right? So we have like a many different strategies to try and meet people where they're at to gather their ideas. And so, you know, so we've got a long list of ideas, and then community members, in this case called project delegates, they come together and they meet in committees that are like based on different themes, right? So maybe there's like a streets and safety committee and a, you know, like a parks and public spaces committee, right? So a couple different, several different committees, the residents meet in those committees and they look at all the ideas related to that theme. And they just go through a process that I won't get into too much detail on, but they go, you know, go through an in-depth months long process to narrow down and figure out what are the greatest needs, what are the projects that can address those needs, and what's feasible within the budget, right? Like we're probably not gonna be able to like, I don't know, people have been talking about, we need a pool, right? Maybe with the amount of money we have, we can't build a whole pool, right? But we may be able to do some other things. So they meet, in this case, the delegates will meet until around April. And they'll, you know, figure out the budgets, come up with the actual project proposals. And then we'll go back out to the community with those projects, and residents will get to vote. Right, so this is an example from Central Falls of the ballot that they created in one of their participatory budgeting processes. And so, you know, usually there's like anywhere from around 10 to 20 projects that end up on the ballot, and community members get to come out and vote and decide, you know, decide on what they actually want to see funded. And then from there, right, the ideas that have received the most votes will get implemented, in this case, by the HES backbone organization, so LISC or One Neighborhood Builders. And so that will, you know, the money will actually get out to the projects that were selected after the voting happens.
Thank you so much. That really does help kind of paint the picture of the all the various steps along the way, and the fact that especially with the amount of resources that we're talking about for each of these projects, it's an in-depth process that takes a while, rightfully so. I wanted to turn it to Liz. I was wondering if you could share a little bit about some of the outreach strategies that your team has been executing to try to ensure that members of the community are submitting ideas. And then maybe if there's some ideas that you know of that you that have been submitted by members of the community, It'd be great if we could share a few of those too, just to help the folks on the call here get a sense of the kinds of needs that are, you know, bubbling to the top.
Yes. So Pam mentioned a couple of our strategies. We have a really strong outreach team. We work with our YMCA community canvassers who do a lot of outreach and canvassing with flyering. With the community town halls, we had two town halls, one in Pawtucket and one in Central Falls, that had more adults with some youth participation. But the youth equity leaders at the Pawtucket YMCA, which is a group of about 30 youth, they led their own town hall, and it was like completely led by the youth with facilitation by the youth, and they were able to engage about 80 youth into the space, and they created it a basketball tournament to attract the youth to come to the space. It was a beautiful Saturday where over 80 youth came together, and some of the things we were hearing from the youth more was around affordable housing and youth programs and after school programs for the youth to continue engagement. In the town halls that we had more adults, it was also housing, which is everyone would know is a crisis happening now, but also a lot around substance use and mental health services, food and nutrition, community clinical linkages, and like public spaces, enhancing our public spaces. So we've gone to festivals, we've gone to coffee hours, we have our upcoming event collection ideas happening at public housing in Pawtucket and Central Falls. We have drop boxes, and we also have our online portal, deciderye.org, where anyone either from Central Providence or Pawtucket Central Falls can log on and submit an idea online. And you don't have to be a resident to submit an idea, but in the voting process, that's when you have to be a resident to vote. And some of our processes are different around our change agents and budget delegates being residents. But yeah, anyone can submit an idea, and I would encourage anyone to get on DecideRI or go to our many access points on submitting an idea. And DecideRI has a lot of information about our outreach upcoming events, where our drop boxes are located, and how you can sign up to be a change agent.
Thank you so much. And you can see that Allie has dropped the DecideRI.org web address in the chat as well for anyone who's interested in checking it out. I am going to ask one more question, then I'm going to open it up to the entire audience here. So start thinking on those questions that you might want to ask. But I would like to direct this next question to Dominique. And we just heard so many of the wonderful strategies that the Pawtucket Central Falls HES is leading. I know there's some similar things happening in Central Providence. As you look ahead to the phase of the process where we'll be getting out the vote, essentially, so, you know, next spring, early summer, can you talk about some of the thinking that's gone into what that process might look like, knowing that it'll continue to be shaped by the steering committee and by residents and, you know, more thinking that's happening in the months to come?
Yeah, and, you know, it's definitely on our mind. The steering committee set the goal of 10% of Central Providence voting in PB, which is around 7,000 votes. So we have a very ambitious goal. And so, you know, some of the ideas that we've started to, you know, come up with for kind of getting out the vote, like Maria said, as much as we can meet people where they're at. So really thinking about where can these voting locations be, where people are already going, right? Like, how can we, you know, utilize like childcare pickups as an opportunity for people to vote? How can we, you know, just go to where people already are? There's been a lot of conversations about creative placemaking and how can we do some more kind of artistic strategies to let people know that this voting is happening. I think also we are, you know, this will also be a time to really lean on our project delegates. I think a big role of them is as they're making these proposals is also letting people know to vote, right? Like they're working on, let's say, an after-school program, and they can, you know, they're letting their networks know, hey, this is one of the many things that are going to be up for voting. We want you to come out. Lots of canvassing, lots of conversations. I think PB, because it's so new, and I think especially in Providence, there is, you know, rightful skepticism about projects. And I think something that's been really important in this process is building relationships with people and really explaining what this process is, and that people are, you know, you're voting on actual money. You know, you're not voting on a person that is gonna maybe spend the money the way they said that they're gonna spend it, but you're actually voting on the projects themselves. And I think that is an extremely important message to get across when it comes to getting out the vote. You're also going to be able to vote online at DecideRI, but I think also utilizing, you know, we also, you know, I think something we've been doing a lot is working really closely with our libraries, understanding that they're already a place where people go. And so we have, we hosted one of our events, one of our town halls at the Smith Hill Library. We have drop boxes at the Mount Pleasant Library and the Olneyville Library. You know, also really working closely with our elected officials and you know, going to their constituent events to let people know there that this is happening and that voting will be happening come spring. And, you know, as, you know, the other great thing is anybody that goes to school or lives in 02908, 02909 can vote, which means anybody that, you know, so that's 13 and older. So all of the students at Mount Pleasant High will actually be able to vote as well. So tapping into that school community as well.
Thank you so much, Dominique. And thanks to all the panelists. And we're now going to open it up to other folks on the call. If you have a question you'd like to ask, feel free to just come off mute and share it. Or if you'd prefer to type it in the chat, please feel free to do that as well.
I wanted to, good morning again, everyone. I wanted to ask Liz, in terms of the community outreach, you mentioned about flyering, and going out in the community and bringing those things. How do you feel that that's working in terms of the outreach rather than the other things that you're trying?
The COVID pandemic showed us the impact of canvassing, door-to-door canvassing, getting information out there. And I think the special thing that has is have the capacity to be able to do is to ensure that we're interpreting and translating all of our communication material in languages that are representative of the community. For example, in Pawtucket and Central Falls, it's English, Spanish, Portuguese, Cape Verdean, Creole, and we're lucky that we have that capacity to be able to support those dominant languages. So the outreach efforts, providing that other level of assistance, even if it's transportation assistance, ensuring that our locations are on bus routes, or providing that accommodation, childcare services, and different things to ensure that we can get the community members that are representative, even if English is not their first language, into our doors. So the outreach, the canvassing, face-to-face interactions really go a long way, because you're able to have that person right there, explain the program, and get them engaged like on that first point of contact.
What about the feedback from them, from the actual community? How has that been?
Because Central Falls has done this process a couple of times, I wouldn't say that we've, and even in Pawtucket, haven't gotten much bad feedback. The only thing that we have been getting is like $385K is not enough money. We need more of that. And it's very, very admirable that One Neighborhood Builders was able to get that private funding to be able to match that. And it's something that LISC will continue to explore on opportunities. But most of it is like, that's not enough money. But for the most part, we've been getting a good amount of engagement in very different community members that otherwise wouldn't have a seat at the table into our doors and letting us understand their lived experience and really trying to come together to make a change.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you very much. Any additional questions?
Really quick, I just want to acknowledge that we have another steering committee member on the call. So I just wanted to give a shout out to Nada. Thank you for also joining us.
Yeah, thank you for having me. And this is really exciting work. I'm super excited about the process, the people I'm working with as a resident of Providence. I'm formerly a resident of Newport, so coming back and sort of stepping in into the similar work that I was also involved in the Newport Heads is very exciting. So I appreciate all of the support and the new relationships that I have been building here in Providence. I definitely am looking forward to sort of becoming more familiar with the community and the needs of the community, and also meeting new residents, because it's really important to have resident voices at the table when decision-making conversations are happening. So thank you for the opportunity and for the relationships and for the, these type of meetings. I really do appreciate it. So thank you for all the great work, everyone.
Thank you, Neda, and thanks for joining us. As you all continue to noodle on other questions you have, because I'm sure they exist, I'm going to throw another one out there, which is, so we heard about decideri.org as a place where folks can learn more and also submit ideas at this stage of the process. If folks on the call are residents, are they live or work or play in these two communities, or they know folks who do, are there other opportunities for getting involved, and what would you recommend both for Liz and for Dominique and for Maria, anyone who has any ideas on this?
Well, as we mentioned earlier, anybody can submit an idea. Both of the PB processes decided that we weren't going, if somebody has a good idea and they live in another area, we wouldn't turn them away. So anybody can submit an idea. And then if you live in 02908 or 02909, for our project, you can sign up to be a project delegate. And so that role, we're actually currently recruiting for that now. So if there's if this is for the people that, maybe you're very passionate about a certain area, maybe you're really passionate about safe streets, or you're really passionate about education programs for youth. This is an opportunity to take these really broad ideas that people have submitted and turn them into ballot ready proposals. So that would definitely be a great next step.
Thank you, Dominique. Do you mind dropping the link into the chat, Dom, of the form that you can fill out if you're interested in becoming a project delegate for the Nine Neighborhood Fund?
Yeah.
Thank you. Liz or Maria or Pam, any of you want to add anything to that that question?
No, same of what Dom said about anyone submitting an idea. The only piece that I wanted to highlight is the budget delegates having the opportunity to connect with specialists from any area, if it's public spaces, and getting into planning departments and really hashing out those ideas and understanding, is it a realistic project? Is this something that can be done? Is it legal? Are we able to implement it? So I think that's super important, getting that interaction from residents, with a specialist that is that works in that area every day to kind of guide us in the right direction. But yeah, we will continue to take ideas, and we're encouraging anyone to submit them and kind of shake it up for us and get our residents thinking in different ways.
And you all have two more in Pawtucket Central Falls, right? You have two more kind of open events, right? At housing at Forand Manor and Fogarty Manor, right? And that, again, those that information is all on DecideRI. And then also a town hall in 02908, 02909, that's gonna be conducted in Spanish. And Dom, you should jump in with the details about that, but that's going to be on December 10th. Also all the info on DecideRI.
And I'm going to turn us to one question that's come up in the chat, which is, how long should you plan to create the rule book or other expectation setting exercises. So how would you go about doing this? Do you need an external consultant or a technical assistance provider like Pam, which we've been so grateful to have as part of this process? Do you need someone with that kind of expertise to support this kind of process? Liz and Dominique are both nodding emphatically. Could you say a word about that?
Pam is a great, just giving us the timeline and kind of bringing in different PB processes that she's been a part of and giving us insight on how long typically it takes to create a rule book or how long the idea collection should be, how long the budget delegate phase should be. But yes, I definitely think you need a technical assistance provider to help with all the documentation pieces of it and just continue to guide us in the way of PB and ensuring that we're staying democratic and ensuring that the processes are really effective in both cities. But feel free to add on, but definitely get a TA.
Yeah, absolutely. Just in the templates alone, and there's so many small decisions that go into creating a rule book that without Pam, like, we wouldn't even know what goes into a rule book in the first place. I would add something else to keep in mind as you're creating a rule book that I think is something that if we could go back, we would have been more focused on from the start is trust building among steering committee members. As Maria had mentioned, there were some times where there was some clashing happening. And some of that was, and as what I had kind of noticed, and Maria and Nada, feel free to jump in, but as people got to know each other a little better, they were more willing to kind of switch to reach consensus because as folks get to know each other, we all know that people are kind of coming at, like, had a better idea of where people were coming from, and thus were like willing to be a little more flexible. And so I think if I could go back in time, I would have been a little more intentional at the beginning of making sure people really knew each other in the room and really knew why everybody was there in the first place before like getting right into like decision making.
Yeah, I'd love to give made a really good point in the chat. Like, we're all learning from Pam, and we hope this is a pilot program. We're definitely going to be open to sharing our experience, our best practices, and everything that we have is documented to the respect both cities. And so we'll have a lot of information that we can share forward to any future backward agencies that would like to engage in these PB processes.
Thank you so much. And as we're hitting 9:30, I just want to take this opportunity to thank all of the panelists for their time, insight, expertise. This was a really fabulous opportunity for sharing some of the learning that's happened so far. And thank you to steering committee members and volunteers and other folks who've been involved in the process for also joining the discussion here today. And thanks just for taking some time out of your Friday morning. I hope you'll consider joining One Neighborhood Builders for future Fresh Friday sessions. We aim to hold them about once a month, always on Friday mornings at this same time. If you've joined us today, that means you're getting an email from us in the future about the next one. So take a look out and check out One Neighborhood Builders' website for recordings of past Fresh Friday sessions on a handful of other topics related to community development. Thank you so much. Have a great Friday.
Thanks, everyone.